Well, good morning again.
Good morning.
Welcome to True Grace Bible Ministry. Nice to have you folks with us. Again, my name is Mike Moraczewski. We're located in central Pennsylvania, about an hour north of Harrisburg, 88 miles due east of State College. All right, well, we've been talking about the books of James, Peter, and John, and who they're written to, and so far we talked about the book of James last week, and we looked into the content of it, and I think we've clearly seen that the book of James is not written to the church, the body of Christ, but to the 12 scattered tribes of Israel. Now, just to make a point, those ones that are scattered abroad, the 12 tribes, within the tribes, okay, we have Jewish proselytes, okay? So within those ones scattered abroad, you have Gentiles, but they are within that little flock, okay, who have become Jews and are partakers. And that's why I put in those as the grafted in ones from Romans 11 that are now partakers of the root and the fatness of the olive tree. They partake of everything Israel was given, okay? So the 12 tribes that are scattered, and the scattered ones we're going to see here from Peter, include those Gentile proselytes, okay? So that's what we looked at last week. And the proof of this that we started with, our springboard, comes from Galatians chapter 2. And as we've opened up the past few weeks, that Galatians chapter 2 coincides with Acts chapter 15, which is the Jerusalem Council, where there was these Pharisees saying that these Gentiles that were coming in now had to follow the law of Moses and be circumcised in order to be saved. And that's where the dispensation, the argument came in, and they sent Paul and Barnabas up to straighten it out. Okay? And this is where we stand here now in Galatians chapter 2, and this is one of the outcomes of that Jerusalem Council. In verse 6, it says, "But of these who seem to be somewhat, whatsoever they were, it maketh no matter to me, God accepted no man's person. For they who seem to be somewhat in conference added nothing to me. But contrariwise, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me, as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter." And we looked at that, okay, that the gospel of circumcision and the gospel of the uncircumcision was rooted in Abraham, but the gospel of the uncircumcision was at faith alone, that Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness. But the gospel of the circumcision had to do with faith plus their works. And we open that up in James as well as back there in Genesis chapter 22, we've seen that. So in verse 8 now, "For he that wrought effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision, the same was mighty in me toward the Gentiles. And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived that the grace was given to me, unto me, that they gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we should go unto the heathen, and they to the circumcision." So that they that are going to the circumcision is James, Peter, and John. So that's who they're writing to. So these epistles, which have been dubbed the general epistles, and I think they dubbed them the general epistles because they didn't know what to do with them, but I think a better title for them would be the Hebrew epistles or the Jewish epistles, because that's who they're written to. Okay? They're written to the circumcision, which include Gentile proselytes. We always have to remember that as well. And that's where we've been springboarding from, and we did it for James in the prior weeks. Excuse me. And then what we did, we went back to Romans 11. Okay, Romans 11. And we showed when the time period is that these books were written to these folks. And it was written during the time period of the mid-Acts to the end of the book, okay? When they were diminishing away. And we know from the scripture here in verse 9, It says, and David said, let their table be a snare and a trap and a stumbling block and a recompense unto them. Let their eyes be darkened that they may not see, and bow down their back always. I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? God forbid. But rather through their fall, salvation is come unto the Gentiles to provoke them to jealousy. And that's what we see in Acts chapter 10 with Peter going to Cornelius. Now, if the fall of them be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them be the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? Okay? So what we see here is the stumbling, the table, which they should have known, the cross work was prophesied about. But that's where they stumbled. They stumbled at the cross. And then when we come out through to Stephen, they blasphemed the Holy Ghost. That is the fall of Israel. But God did not stop right then and there with the nation of Israel. They diminished away. So through the rest of the book of Acts here, after Acts chapter 7, they diminished away until Acts chapter 28, when I'm going to use the phrase that God officially set them aside when he says that salvation has gone to the Gentiles. And that diminishing away took 30 to 35 years. It just didn't happen all of a sudden. That's what diminish means. So when James, Peter, and John had that right hand of fellowship with Paul and Barnabas, okay, in Acts chapter 15, which we see also opened up, and Paul again explains in Galatians chapter 2, this is what's happening. You have, as I've said before, two programs going on at the same time. You have that prophecy program with the nation of Israel, which is diminishing away, and then you have the church, the body of Christ, the revelation of the mystery, and everything included in that was given to Paul, and it's starting to build. So you have two programs going on at the same time. And James, Peter, and John went to the circumcision, where Paul and Barnabas and the boys went to the uncircumcision. And that's what we've opened up to give an understanding of when these books are written. Okay? And we're going to continue on, and we're going to see again that, you know, they were still following the law. They were zealous for the law. As far as Acts chapter 20, they were still looking for the kingdom. See, we know the rest of the story. But at that time, they didn't know. Okay? They didn't know. And this is what Peter's writing. Because what they do, the next thing for them, on the horizon, if you would, is in the prophetic calendar, they knew tribulation was coming. They were looking for their kingdom. And we're going to see that as well. And that's why James, Peter, and John writes to these folks, preparing them to go through the tribulation and awaiting the kingdom. And then we're going to see that, the appearing of the kingdom here, and I think it's like verses 4 and 5 of 1 Peter. So, as we opened up James last week, we're going to go through now, and we're going to look at Peter. And so, go to 1 Peter. And as we do, we're not going to start at verse 1 this morning. What I want us to do is to go down to verse 9. And then we're going to go back through and come down through the first 7 verses and just see that Peter cannot be writing to the church, the body of Christ. We just don't fit there. Okay? And over years, I believe the church, so to speak, they forced Peter into the church, the body of Christ, for us because of some of this language. All I ask, Peter talks about the death, burial, and resurrection here. He talks about the blood, about being born again. But who needs to be born again? Israel. We are brand new creations, okay? We are not born again. Remember, I made the statement before, if we were born again, we'd be born back into Adam. It just doesn't fit, and also doesn't make sense, does it? So, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 9. It says, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. Now, we've seen from Galatians chapter 2 that Peter is to go to the circumcision. He's the apostle to the circumcision. So the you here would be the circumcision, would be the Jew, not us, the church, the body of Christ, okay? But the key things we want to look at here is of which salvation. See, salvation was promised to the nation of Israel just as it is for us, okay? But one is prophecy and one is mystery. And that's the key to understanding Scripture, is to study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And when we rightly divide the word of truth, it's not that Old Testament from New Testament, but it's prophecy from mystery. And here we see in verse 10, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. See, every time we hear that word grace, we can't think of dispensation of grace in us. I mean, God is gracious. He's been gracious from the beginning. He was gracious to Adam. He was gracious to Noah. He was gracious to Abraham and the patriarch and all through history. Okay? So when we see the word grace, we can't think of us in the dispensation of grace. But he showed them grace. And salvation was promised to them. So keep your finger here in 1 Peter. Go back to Luke. And look at what salvation that the prophets were searching for and that were prophesied about. And then we're going to look at our salvation, and we'll see the difference between the two. So in Luke chapter 1, verse 68. And here we see the account with Zacharias. Okay, he's filled with the Holy Ghost concerning his son John. We know as John the Baptist. And verse 68 says, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people." Listen to the pronouns as I go through here, okay? His people. "And has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David." So this horn of salvation that was raised up are for those in the house of the servant David. How many Gentiles are in this house? None. And look at verse 70. "As he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began." So these things that Zacharias here is discussing have been talked about since the world began. And we're going to see about something that was kept secret since the world began for us. Verse 71, "that we," who's the we? It's not us, the church, the body of Christ, but Israel. Remember, Jesus Christ, Romans 15:8, was a minister to the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises of the fathers. That's why Jesus came to minister, to confirm these promises, to confirm this salvation, that we should be saved from our enemies. We have no promise of that in the dispensation of grace, do we? None at all. "And from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers, and remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father Abraham." Yes, Abraham is our spiritual father, but here they're talking about the oath that was given to Abraham for the nation of Israel, that he would grant unto us that we, being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. "And thou, child," now he's getting back to John the Baptist, "and thou, child, shalt be called the prophet of the highest, and shall go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins." So here we see a physical deliverance from their enemies, and also we see the spiritual deliverance to come, which is the forgiveness of their sins. But it's for his people, the knowledge of salvation for his people. Folks, Israel are God's chosen people. They're His people. Remember that, always. Verse 38, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high has visited us, to give light unto them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. And the child grew, John the Baptist, and waxed strong in spirit, and was in the deserts till the day of his showing unto Israel. So, folks, this salvation that is being spoken of, the horn of salvation that was raised up, was for Israel. This is what Peter is talking about here in verse 10. When he says, in verse 9, he says, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come on to you. This is what they were talking about. Okay? Remember, this out of Luke is written to the Jew, not to us, the church, the body of Christ. That's the salvation that Peter's talking about here. And we can see a picture of it there in Luke chapter 1. Remember, Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises unto the fathers. He was, came to the circumcision. And this is who Peter's writing to, the circumcision, not us, the church, the body of Christ. Remember, when we rightly divide, it's between prophecy and mystery. This is prophecy. And Peter says it was prophesied, okay, who prophesied about the grace to come. And we've seen in verse 70 of Luke that it was spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began. But now let's look at a comparison for us today in the dispensation of grace and our salvation. So, Romans 16, 25. Romans 16, 25. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel, that death, burial, and resurrection is what Paul calls my gospel, and the preaching of Jesus Christ. Here's how we're to preach Jesus Christ today. According to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. So, here in Luke, we've seen that that salvation was spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began. And now, this revelation of the mystery and the preaching of Jesus Christ for us today in the dispensation of grace was kept secret since the world began. And as we've seen in Luke, that they were delivered from their enemies. And the showing was to Israel. It was exclusively to the nation of Israel, wasn't it? But now, when we come into 2 Corinthians chapter 5, let's go to verse 18, we see something a little bit different. And again, we're gonna talk about this, the cross work, okay? In verse 18. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. So, the work of the cross today now is this, that God is reconciling the world unto himself. Okay? Where in time past, the salvation was of the Jew. And today he's reconciling both Jew and Gentile into one body. That's the twain, one new man we see out of Ephesians. Okay? The reconciliation was done by the work of the cross. And that cross work, okay? I had somebody say to me that, how can I say that, what is there, separate blood, that the blood that Jesus shed was different for Israel than it is for us? No. It's the same cross. It's the same shed blood. It's the same death. It's the same burial. It's the same resurrection. Okay? But we must rightly divide it. Because that death, burial, and resurrection was prophesied for Israel. But it had a different meaning for them than it does for us. For them, the resurrection meant that they would have this kingdom set up, and we're going to see in Acts chapter 2, verse 30, that he was raised from the dead to sit on the throne of David. But for us today, out of Romans 4, 25, he was raised from the dead that we may be justified. So the salvation, okay, the work of the cross, yes, it all was the, as some would say, the crescendo of it was the cross work. But it had different meanings. It's applied differently. And the way it was applied to Israel was that fulfillment of prophecy. And for us, it was a secret since the world began that God would be reconciling both Jew and Gentile into one body. And that's the difference, okay? The cross work is applied differently. And that's the message if you go to TGBM 1000, the dual purpose of the cross. It shows that, okay? Same cross, same blood, same death, same burial, resurrection, but applied differently. So the salvation for Israel was a physical deliverance from their enemies. And it included the forgiveness of sins. And that's where the new covenant comes in, Jeremiah 31, which is to the nation of Israel. And then because Israel rejected their Messiah, they fell, they diminished away, and now salvation has come to us. And that's why in Timothy, where it says that he paid a ransom for all to be testified in due time. See, we're in the due time now. Now the cross work applies to all. And that's what 2 Corinthians is saying here, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. Okay? So, that salvation that Peter is talking about, I believe, is a better picture of Luke chapter 1, verses 68 to 80, of prophecy. So hopefully you can see the difference of this salvation. Their prophecy was spoken, or their salvation was spoken since the world began. Our salvation was a secret since the world began, not revealed until the Apostle Paul in Galatians chapter 1. And when he talks about my gospel, the gospel that was given to him, he didn't get at, I'm paraphrasing, from man, but he got by revelation of Jesus Christ. Galatians chapter 1, verses 11 and 12. See, there's a difference here, okay? So hopefully we can see that. And that's why I wanted to start in verse 10. To see that this salvation that Peter is talking about is not through the death, burial, and resurrection as it is for us today. That the work of the cross had a dual purpose. Okay? Both have salvation. Israel's salvation will come in the future when the new covenant will be fulfilled. It's not being fulfilled today. We today in the dispensation of grace are not under any covenants. We are not God's covenant people. Okay? We do not partake of the covenants. We are not grafted into any of the covenant promises. Okay? All right. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. We're going to go through these verses now and hopefully and very clearly see that 1 Peter cannot be written to the church, the body of Christ. I mean, Galatians chapter 2, verse 6 to 9 should be enough. But as we know, it's never enough. Okay? So, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. It says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. So we know from Matthew chapter 10 and from Scripture, I think we all know and we'll take the fact that yes, Peter is an apostle of Jesus Christ. And some of the last words that the Lord said to Peter, if you go back to John chapter 21, in verse 14, he says, this now is the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples after that he was risen from the dead. So when they had died, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my lambs. He saith unto him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And he saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest I love thee. He, Jesus, said unto him, Feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he had said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, Feed my sheep. And the reason I did that and went back there to show you this, okay, that Jesus told Peter to feed his sheep. And nowhere, nowhere in Paul's epistles does he ever call us, the church, the body of Christ, sheep. Sheep are always the description of the Jew. Never us. So Jesus told Peter to feed his sheep. All right. And what sheep was he to feed? Okay. Now, we go back to Matthew. Let's go back to Matthew and see who these sheep are that Peter is supposed to feed. Matthew 16, verse 18. And I say unto thee, thou art Peter, upon this rock I will build my church. Now, every time we hear the word church, let's not think of the church, the body of Christ. It's been impounded and embedded into us that church, church, church is us. Just like this morning when I read the word grace, the grace that was showed unto you, right away when we see the word grace, we think of the dispensation of grace. That's not true. Every time we see the word church, it's been embedded in us to think of now. It's not us, the church, the body of Christ. The same thing with gospel. When people are so emphatic that there's only one gospel in the Bible. There's many different gospels in the Bible. Okay? So every time we see the word gospel, church, or grace, it's not always about us today. And this is the church that Jesus is talking about, that he says to Peter, that I will build my church, okay? Jesus is building the church, but he's using Peter to do it. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give unto thee, Peter, the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Folks, the kingdom of heaven is going to be on earth. Okay? This is the, and we're going to see here in a bit, that it's the Jerusalem church, the same church that Paul persecuted. It was not the church, the body of Christ. So, the ones that Peter are feeding, okay, that Jesus told him to feed, are these folks. And he is building this church using Peter, which is the Jerusalem church, which is the Jewish church. For all sakes, I may say, it's Judaism. It's not true what we dub Christianity. Okay, they are not Christians. Paul didn't persecute Christians. He persecuted Jews in the Jewish church along with Gentile proselytes. Now, continuing verse 1. It says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Okay? So these are the ones scattered throughout this area. So, just like we did last week with James, let's go back to Acts chapter 8 and see who these scattered ones are and what they were doing. So we go back to Acts, excuse me, chapter 8, verse 1. And Saul was consenting unto his death, and at that time there was a great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem. See, the church that was at Jerusalem is that church that we just talked about there that Peter was given the keys to. Okay? And they were all scattered abroad, throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial, made great lamentation over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, not the body of Christ's church, entering into every house and healing and hauling men and women, committed them to prison. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Now, again, we mentioned this last week. The only word they had was Old Testament scriptures. Okay? Because as we seen last week out of Colossians chapter 1, verses 24 and 25, that Paul was called and given the word of God by revelation to fulfill or to complete the word of God for us in this dispensation of grace. So the only word they had here in Acts chapter 8, remember, Saul didn't get saved until Acts chapter 9, okay? So the only word they had was Old Testament scriptures. Go to Acts chapter 11, verse 19. Now they which were scattered abroad, okay, they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that arose about Stephen, that's what we just read there in Acts chapter 8, traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word to none but the Jews only. And why did they preach to the Jew only? Because the salvation of God was to the Jew. And that's what they were told to do. That's all they knew. They didn't have the word of God for this dispensation of grace, number one, but they were just doing what they were supposed to do. Okay? And these are the ones that Peter is writing to, back here now in 1 Peter chapter 1, the ones that were scattered abroad. Okay? Verse 2. Let me read verse 1 into verse 2. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect. Okay, the ones he's writing to are elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. Okay, remember in Scripture, Israel as a nation are the elect. Christ himself are the elect. And the church, the body of Christ as a whole, I'll put them in there as elect as well, but not individuals. There's no individual that is elect. It's the church, the body of Christ, okay? The predestination. Now, what we want to get back to here, not get off track, is the elect that he's writing to here. Who are these, okay? Let's go back to Romans 11 again. Keep your finger here. We'll be back. Romans 11, and let's see who the elect are. It's the same elect that James wrote to, by the way. Romans 11, verse 5. Paul says, even so, at this very time. And when he says at this very time, he doesn't mean today, November 30th, 2014. He meant when he was writing the book of Romans. Even so then, at this present time, there is a remnant, at this present time also, there is a remnant according to the election of grace. So this remnant is according to the election of grace. Verse 6. And if by grace, meaning the election, then it is no more works. And all this is saying here is that these folks, this remnant, are a remnant because of God's grace. It has nothing to do with salvation for us in the dispensation of grace, that it's by grace and not by works. And it has nothing to do with this remnant being placed into the body of Christ, that Jews, that this election of grace are the Jews within the body of Christ. That's hogwash as well. Let's just read it for what it says. I do this every week, but I'll keep doing it until it sinks in of who these remnant are. They're according to the election of grace. And that the election is by grace. It's nothing that they've done, but by God's grace. Period. Then it is no more works, otherwise grace is no more work, or grace, but if it be of works, then it is no more work. Grace, otherwise, no more grace, excuse me, otherwise work is no more work. Verse 7. What then? Israel have not obtained that which he seeketh for. Israel was looking for their Messiah, and they were looking for their kingdom. Okay? Israel have not attained what it seeketh for. But the election have obtained it. So, the remnant, according to the election of grace, that have found it, that obtained what it seeketh for, was the kingdom. And he goes on to say that the rest were blinded. So who are these folks here? The remnant according to the election of grace? If we go back to Luke chapter 12, it'll tell us. Verse 32. It says, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Okay? So, these folks, the election of grace, are the little flock. They're not Jews within the church, the body of Christ. That's a wrong teaching of these passages. Okay? If you have questions about that, send me a message. Let me know what you think about it, okay? So, remember what we said from the beginning, that there's two programs going on at the same time. And Paul says at this very time there's a remnant of Jews according to the election of grace, okay? That God's not done with Israel. They're still diminishing away. And to prove that fact, that they were still diminishing away and that they didn't stop, in Acts chapter 21, in verse 20, it says, when they heard it, they glorified the Lord and said unto him, thou seest, brother, how many thousands of Jews there are which believe, and they are zealous of the law. Okay? And then we come down into verse 24, and here we have the elders telling Paul, to shave his head and take a vow. But then he goes down here into the middle of the verse and says, whereof they were informed concerning thee are nothing, but thou thyself also walk orderly and keepest the law. So the law was still in force in Acts chapter 21. And I know it seems confusing, but I must say it, that Paul did both. He did all things. He says, I've become all things to all men. And he kept the law. To me, that's the only way I can put it, he was under the law and under the grace at the same time. And I think he was the only individual that could do that, and it was by God's grace. But that's how I see it. He did both. Now verse 25. It says, as touching Gentiles which believe, we have written and concluded that they observe no such thing. So see the two programs going on at the same time. The Jew was still zealous for the law, but they told Paul that the Gentiles did not have to keep the law. And that's what we see happening. And they were diminishing away. Two programs at the same time. Okay? But the remnant, according to the election of grace, is that little flock who were still under the law, following the law. And they were still looking for the kingdom. Acts 26. Verse 6, Paul talking with King Agrippa, and he says, now I stand and am judged for the hope of the promise made unto God our fathers, unto which promise are 12 tribes instantly serving God day and night, hope to come, for which hope's sake, King Agrippa, I am accused of the Jews. Why should it be thought a thing incredible with you that God should raise the dead? So the 12 tribes, they're still waiting for this kingdom. And as we're going to see in a bit, the purpose of Jesus' resurrection was to sit on the throne of David. That's what they were looking for. And that's why Paul says to King Agrippa that it should be incredible with you that God should raise the dead. See, that was the purpose of Jesus rising from the dead for the nation of Israel, to sit on the throne. Now, for us in the dispensation of grace, he rose from the dead that we may be justified. There's a difference, and which is included in the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. But sitting on the throne of David was spoken by all the mouth of the holy prophets, which we seen in Luke chapter 1, verse 70. So, okay, let's get back to Peter. Let's get back to 1 Peter. Hopefully we can get through this. 1 Peter chapter 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So here we see the resurrection. And I'm not going to say I could, you know, I guess I used to see it too and understand. So I guess I can say, well, I understand a little bit why they put Peter talking to the church, the body of Christ, because here we see the death, burial, and resurrection. But we have to always remember that death, burial, and resurrection was prophecy to the nation of Israel. And for us, the death, burial, and resurrection means something different. Okay? So yes, Peter talks about the death, burial, and resurrection. And let's go back now to Acts chapter 2, and as I've been talking, and see what Peter says about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In Acts chapter 2. Let's go to verse 22. We're going to read it all. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourself also know. Him, being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain, whom God had raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it. For David speaketh concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover also my flesh shall rest in hope, because I will not leave my soul in hell, neither will thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou hast made known to me the ways of life, and thou shalt make full of joy with and make me full of joy with thy countenance. Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulchre is with us unto this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God has sworn with him an oath, that the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne. Okay. The purpose of Jesus' resurrection was to sit on the throne of David. Just so you know, I'm not making this stuff up, okay? Romans 4:25, real quick. And we got to get back to Peter. Verse 25 says, who was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification. Okay? So there's a difference. For the nation of Israel, his resurrection was to sit on the throne of David. For us in the dispensation of grace, which is included in the revelation of the mystery, he was raised for our justification. Okay? All right. 1 Peter chapter 4. Again, we just want to go through Peter, just like I did with James, and show that Peter could not be writing to the church, the body of Christ, because we just don't fit there. Number one. And we have to go by what Scripture says, that he was writing to the circumcision. Okay? So verse 4 goes on to say, let me read some of verse 3 to come into it, that he had begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Now, it says it's reserved in heaven. It doesn't say it's in heaven and it's going to be in heaven. because we know that this kingdom that they're awaiting for, the throne of David that Jesus is going to sit on, is going to be on earth. Okay? But here we see that it's reserved for them in heaven. And if we go back to Acts chapter 2 again, continue reading on in verse 30. We just read verse 30, that Jesus would sit on the throne. He saying this before spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption. This Jesus hath God raised up, whereof all we are all witnesses. Therefore, being at the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed forth this which ye now see and hear. That's what happened on the day of Pentecost. For David is not ascended into the heavens, but saith himself, the Lord saith unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand until thy foes, until I make thy foes thy footstool. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God had made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. So, here is this inheritance reserved in heaven. The Lord Jesus Christ is still sitting at the right hand of the Father, okay? But at this time, he was there at the right hand of the Father. Because remember, the revelation of the mystery was a secret since the world began, and all the doctrine and teachings for the church were not revealed until the Apostle Paul after Acts chapter 9. So when they're talking about that he is seated at the right hand of the Father until I make thy foes thy footstool, what he's talking about here, he's seated at the right hand of the Father until after the tribulation. Then he's going to come back and set up this earthly kingdom. Okay? But this earthly kingdom is reserved in heaven. But the earthly kingdom, obviously called the earthly kingdom for a purpose, because it's going to be on earth, isn't it?
Yes.
And that's what Jeremiah says. Back there in Jeremiah 23, verse 5. Behold, the days cometh, saith the Lord, that I will raise up David, a righteous branch, and a king shall reign and prosper, and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth. In his days Judah shall be saved, and Israel shall dwell safely. And this is the name whereby he shall be called, the Lord our righteousness. So this kingdom, this promise, here we see Peter talking about the inheritance, which is incorruptible, which is reserved in heaven for you, the circumcision, is this kingdom. Because Jesus was sitting at the right hand of the Father until he makes thy enemies thy foe. Wait. Until, here we go. To make thy foes thy footstool. Okay? Okay, Psalm chapter 110, verse 1. Okay? He says, until he make thy enemies thy footstool. Okay? So, that's what Peter's talking about here. This kingdom is reserved in heaven until Christ comes back. We're going to keep reading Peter here, and he goes in to say that. But let's look a little bit more about this inheritance that Peter is talking about. An inheritance incorruptible. And we talked about the earth. Okay? Matthew chapter 5, verse 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into the mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Folks, these Beatitudes are written to the nation of Israel. Remember, Romans 15:8. Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises of the fathers. Also, continuing on with this inheritance in Matthew, go to Matthew 19. Their inheritance also included eternal life, just like us. Okay? But theirs was spoken since the world began, ours was a secret since the world began. Matthew 19. Then answered Peter and said unto him, behold, we are forsaken all and follow thee. What shall we have therefore? And Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto you, they which have followed me, and the regeneration when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory. That's what we read there in Acts chapter 2, didn't we? Ye also shall sit upon the 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And every one that has forsaken house or brethren or sister or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive an hundredfold and shall inherit eternal life. Go to Matthew 25, verse 31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all his holy angels with him, then shall he sit on the throne of his glory, and before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, and the goats on his left. Then shall the king say unto them, on his right hand, come ye, blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. See, these sheep are the nation of Israel. Because when Jesus Christ is sitting on his throne, we're going to be ruling and reigning with Christ in heaven, not on earth. Okay? This inheritance that Peter is talking about is the kingdom. Okay? It's the kingdom. The little flock. Peter is writing to the little flock. They were given the kingdom. This is what they were looking for. This is what they were waiting for. Okay? But one thing to remember, at that time when these things were written, the church, the body of Christ, was a secret, which is included in the revelation of the mystery. Okay, verse 5 of 1 Peter chapter 1. It says, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Okay? The last time that Peter is talking about. Because remember, they're looking for the kingdom to come. And let's read through here. In the last time, wherein you are greatly rejoiced, through now for a season, if ye need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith, being more precious than gold that perish, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto the praise and honor of the glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Okay? So, here we see now in verse 5, he's talking about the last time. Again, if we go back to Acts chapter 2, Peter uses the same wording back here in Acts chapter 2 in verse 16 when he says, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, and it shall come to pass in the last days I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall